In this video, we're building an AI-powered automation where the moment your last family member walks out the door, n8n triggers a scan of every device in your home, AI identifies anything that's still running and shouldn't be, and then Home Assistant shuts them all down automatically. Honestly, this whole workflow just boils down to a simple query, check, action pattern. All right, so let's dive into n8n and actually build this AI housekeeper. The first thing we need is a trigger. Now, if you're a Home Assistant user, your first instinct is probably to look for a state change trigger, but you'll quickly find it doesn't exist in n8n's trigger node. So for this project, we have to use a webhook. Think of a webhook as a unique private URL. When Home Assistant tells us the last person has left, it will simply visit this URL, which instantly kicks off our entire n8n workflow. I'll set the HTTP method to post, give it a path called webhook, and copy the production URL for later. Okay, our trigger is ready. The moment it fires, what's the first thing our AI needs? Information. It needs a complete snapshot of every single device in the house. This is the query part of our pattern. For that, we'll add a Home Assistant node and use the getMiniStates operation. Now, here's the first critical mistake a lot of people make. You have to check this return all box. If you don't, n8n will only grab the first 100 devices, and your AI might completely miss that one light you left on in the basement. So now we have the data, but if you look at the output, it's a mess. Each device comes with a ton of extra information we don't need, like last changed, context. It's just noise. If we send all this junk to the AI, it's slow and costs too much token, so we need to clean it up. We'll add an edit fields node, which is our information filter. I'll configure it to only keep the three things our AI actually needs to make a decision: the entity ID, so we know what to turn off, the state, so we know if it's on or off, and the friendly name, so we can read it easily. This one step makes our automation faster. All right, our data is clean, but now we have a structural problem. We have a stream of separate items, maybe 50 devices, all in a single file line. If we send this to the AI, it will analyze them one by one and give us 50 separate reports. That's useless. We need the AI to look at the entire list at once and give us a single consolidated plan. To do that, we need to bundle them all together. That's the job of the aggregate node. We'll set it to all item data. This transforms our stream of individual items into a single package containing one complete list, which is the exact format our AI needs to see the big picture. With our data perfectly prepared, it's time to bring in the brains of the operation, the AI agent. In the prompt, I'm giving it a clear set of rules. You are a home automation security system. Analyze this list of devices. Identify any lights or switches that are on and any locks that are unlocked. But here's the pro move. We can't just trust the AI to give us a simple text answer. We need a guaranteed machine-readable output. So I'm using a structured output parser. I'll give it a JSON example of exactly the format I want my to-do list to be in. And this is key, I'll enable auto-fix format and assign a second AI model, Gemini, to it. This creates a fail-safe. If the first Gemini gets a bit creative with its response, the second Gemini's only job is to force it back into our perfect JSON structure. Okay, the AI has done its job and given us a clean to-do list. But what if the list is empty because we remembered to turn everything off? We don't want the workflow to continue and potentially cause errors. This is where a simple if node comes in. It's a fork in the road. I'll set the condition to check if the length of our AI's actions list is greater than zero. If it is, the workflow continues down the true path. If not, it stops right here. So assuming there's work to do, we have one final data problem. The true output from the if node is still a single item containing a list of actions. But our final node, the one that actually controls Home Assistant, can only handle one action at a time. This is a classic one-to-many problem. We solve this with a code node. Now, don't be intimidated. We just need a tiny snippet of JavaScript that takes our list of actions and splits them back up into individual, separate items. Now, instead of one item with a list inside, we have a stream of individual items again, each one a single actionable task. And that brings us to the final action step, the call a service node. This is our universal remote control. And here's the magic. I'm not hard coding anything. The domain is set to whatever the domain is from our code node's output. Likewise, the service is set to the service output, and the entity ID is set to the entity ID output. This means this single node can dynamically turn off a light, flip a switch, or lock a door, all depending on the instructions it receives from the previous step. Because our code node created a stream of items, this call a service node will automatically run once for every single item on our to-do list, until the job is done. All right, the n8n workflow is complete, we'll activate it. Now let's jump back into Home Assistant to build the trigger. First, you'll need to set up people in your settings, one for each family member, and link them to a device tracker like their phone. Then, in your configuration.yaml file, you'll create a group that includes all of those people. While you're in there, create a REST command and paste in that webhook URL we copied from our very first node. With that done, the final step is a simple automation. The trigger will be our family group state changing from home to not home. And the action? Simply call the REST command we just created. And now, the payoff. When I take all our devices and leave the house, the Home Assistant automation fires, it calls the n8n webhook, the entire workflow runs in an instant, and any devices we forgot about are automatically turned off. By the way, for a detailed write-up with all the steps, code, and prompts from this video, the link to the full tutorial is down in the description. Let me know down in the comments which topic you'd like me to explore next. As always, your likes and subscribes are what keep me motivated to dig into these projects. Thanks for watching, and I'll catch you in the next one.